Hi everyone, I'm Dr. Ramani Durvasula, and today I'm going to be talking about gaslighting and grief and talking about narcissism and narcissistic abuse. We find ourselves in some interesting and in some unsettling times. Now, as psychologists and as mental health practitioners, understanding personality and the attendant behavioral patterns that spring from personality have become essential to understand. In all disciplines of psychology, social, personality, developmental, clinical, we have often relegated personality to the understanding of the individual, but it is becoming increasingly clear that opening up this conversation to understanding systemic issues is also necessary. Otherwise, we are going to keep running in the same circles. So let me start with a timely conjecture. As I prepare this lecture, the United States is in the throes of the COVID-19 pandemic. As of today in the United States, 2.86 million people have become infected, 132,000 have died. Since April of 2020, public health officials throughout the country have made some economically complicated, albeit behaviorally simple recommendations. One of these is wear a mask. It seems simple, right? Now here's the challenge. People are clearly not listening, and understandably, after months of staying at home and living in uncertainty, people wanted to leave the house. They wanted the touchstones of their usual routines. But wear a mask seemed simple. Leave your house, cover your face, go home, take it off. Now, interestingly, mask wearing is in fact an intervention that may do more to protect the other person than the self. So there's sort of some empathy built into the willingness to wear a mask. Yet, people are refusing to wear them. And they're also violating other recommendations, such as larger gatherings, usually without masks. Now, people's reasons for not wearing them range from the conspiratorial, the pandemic is a falsehood, to the unempathic, if you don't want to get sick, then don't leave the house. I'm not going to wear a mask. You wear one if you want. To the oppositional, you aren't going to tell me what to do. To the entitled, other people can wear them, but I don't want to, nor should I have to. To the, I am tired of being at home and I have to go to a bar now, which would reflect challenges in reward delay and impulsivity. So let's take a look there. We got some lack of empathy, entitlement, mild persecutory ideation, oppositionality, reward seeking and impulsivity. Sounds a lot like narcissism to me. And if we were to understand a massive public health crisis and its response through the lens of narcissism, personally, I believe we may be better prepared from a public health perspective for what's to come. It's actually frustrating and sad to watch public health officials appeal to the empathy of the mask deniers. This is for our greater good. This will help everyone, or to distill rewards. If you follow the rules now, you can have your bar time later, to asking people to follow restrictions without any meaningful consequence in the face of non-adherence. And if any of you have ever tried to put a three-year-old to bed, you know that's not going to work. You need consequences. So you may wonder, what would I, someone who cares actually quite deeply about narcissism, tell any public official who would be willing to listen, you know, to my inconsequential thoughts about how to link what we know about narcissism to addressing the public health response to COVID? For example, mask wearing. I'm going to tell him, this ain't going to change. Our rule of law in this country is such that no entity is willing or perhaps able to set down appropriate consequences for a substantial chunk of mask deniers. And you know, not all, but more than a few of mask deniers are really showing a narcissistic pattern characterized by entitlement, lack of empathy, and oppositionality. And this pattern is clearly afoot. And you can't change that pattern unless you plan on making a lot of free and mandatory psychotherapy available for people to work on issues of self-reflective capacity and legacy issues really fast. Clearly, that's not going to happen. So the fact is, the public health departments in America are going to have to figure out a workaround. Now, I get it. Maybe I'm reaching. But watching my own city of Los Angeles struggle with new infections and demands on the healthcare system, and nobody willing to see personality styles such as narcissism as an important pattern to at least identify, feels like they may be missing an important and enlightening piece of a puzzle. We know these patterns are not amenable to change, such as narcissism, but perhaps the pandemic is the time when we can see how certain personality styles may be important to consider in how we realistically construct public health responses. But alas, narcissism has become an ugly word in clinical psychology. It often gets sneered at as psychopathological name-calling. And we as a field are quite inconsistent. The measurement of narcissism in social and the personality worlds of psychology captures a construct that is more congruent with assertiveness, grandiosity, and a propensity to need to be sort of the boss or a leader, in contrast to the nuanced clinical picture that has been beautifully articulated by researchers including Elsa Roningsam, by Pincus, by Campbell. A picture that goes beyond the one-dimensional, grandiose, entitled sort of performer and expands into fragility, resentment, sullenness, petulance, shame, reactivity, negative emotionality, or as variable and vulnerable self-esteem. Narcissism is actually a bit of a late entry in the psychiatric diagnostic world. Narcissistic personality disorder didn't even enter the DSM until 1980. And despite old school folks like Freud and Rank talking about it in the early part of the 20th century, and Kernberg and Kohut dusting it off in the 20th century, later in the 20th century, other than psychoanalysts, nobody has really wanted to take a crack at it, and who can blame them? In the DSM-5, the conversation shifted, and the dimensional and trait-based models allowed us the opportunity to sort of sidestep the dirty narcissism word and use other useful terms like antagonistic, which is a higher order construct that captures manipulativeness, deceitfulness, grandiosity, attention-seeking, callousness, and hostility. That, coupled with understanding the attendant patterns in a narcissistic personality style, a sense of self and goal setting governed by the validation of others, empathy deficits, and incapacity for reciprocal intimacy, have allowed us to talk about these issues without falling into just talking about the big, bad, forbidden word, narcissism. Now, I often use the acronym CAVED to communicate with clients and professional audiences as a way to sort of minimize the use of a third rail term like narcissism. CAVED, as I use it, stands for conflictual, antagonistic, vulnerable, entitled, and dysregulated. It gives us an opportunity to deconstruct a stigmatized construct into its component parts and enable a conversation and not just shut the conversation down before it even begins. And it may help orient people to the personality issues that they may be up against without leaving them concerned about using a sort of a judgy word, whether that's in their personal lives or in public health. So we don't want to talk about narcissism. And interestingly, a significant proportion of clinical training programs do not even have a full semester course on the impact of personality on psychopathology, the impact of personality on therapy, or on personality disorders, let alone on high conflict styles such as narcissism, borderline personality, antisocial personality, styles that may feel difficult to treat, but often do result in significant time and resource demands in clinical and in medical settings. And this goes beyond the distinction between narcissistic personality disorder and narcissism, which is where we so often get stuck. Rates of NPD in the population hover somewhere around 1 to 6%, depending on the study methodology. And because few studies look at subclinical narcissism, other than those studies that use social or personality tools that capture assertiveness and grandiosity in large samples, it's very difficult to discern the true prevalence of the multifaceted sort of clinical construct of narcissism. But the sticking point can become whether someone meets diagnostic criteria. Alan Francis points out that NPD is tricky because in order to get the diagnosis, one needs to not only have the laundry list of grandiosity and arrogance and lack of empathy and all the rest of it, but to also meet the criteria of subjective distress or impairment. Many narcissistic personalities have neither subjective impairment or distress, and the judgments of other people really don't count. Often by a narcissist's own estimation, they're doing just fine. So does it matter if this pattern reaches a threshold? Does it have to be diagnostic? Antagonistic patterns such as narcissism are still problematic for the person living with it and for the person around them. So another oft-cited antagonistic sort of vulnerable personality style, borderline personality, has received significant clinical research attention. And the work of Marsha Linehan and others have clearly demonstrated the utility of dialectical behavior therapy as an evidence-based practice that addresses the maladaptive behavioral patterns manifested in BPD and managing the suicidal crises that render BPD at times a dangerous mental health pattern for the person experiencing it. Most importantly, dialectical behavioral therapy as a therapy has also been scaled to work in short-term models delivered by therapists with a range of training and with more diverse populations. But alas, we have not seen this with narcissistic personality styles. A thorough review shows that numerous models have been used and tested in research studies and have shown differential clinical utility. These include transference-focused psychotherapy, metacognitive interpersonal therapy, schema therapy, functional analytic psychotherapy, contemporary relational psychotherapy, mentalization-based treatment. Yet, these studies can be hampered by limited generalizability and assumptions of therapy access that simply do not exist in the United States at this time. Any of you who have ever worked with narcissistic clients, and that's if you could even retain them in therapy, dropout rates as high as 64% have been observed. Clinicians tend to sort of cobble together what works to keep these clients in therapy. Progress, if any, is slow. And if we stop and reflect at our frustration in working with clients with these personality patterns, we have a tiny idea of what the people in the narcissist's lives are enduring. So the data and our collective clinical experience do suggest that in many cases, especially in narcissistic individuals who lack sufficient self-reflective capacity or who are not at all motivated to change, the likelihood of change is very low. So then we plunge into a new challenge, which is how these personality styles impact other people. The short answer, not good. But because clinicians are trained to not talk about the people who are not in the room in any other way than to sort of skirt the issue of how they impact our clients, psychoeducation about the personality patterns happening around the client is often limited. It's interesting because it's in contrast when a person is living with or impacted, for example, by a family member with other mental health issues such as addiction or bipolar disorder. Education programs are often offered, and research shows that they help. So why aren't we doing this with narcissism? So first, let's take a brief foray through the kinds of clinical situations where this may play out that you might see in your office. A spouse who has been chronically invalidated, gaslighted, and emotionally negated by an entitled and antagonistic spouse. And let's throw some infidelity in there too. An older adult who is living in fear of a rageful, entitled, chronically victimized, and resentful adult child. A woman who is harassed, intimidated, subjected to verbal abuse, belittled, and preyed upon in the workplace. Or an adult who is still grappling with confusion and pain about a parent who scapegoated them, brought no emotional mirror, critiques every element of the client's life, and then denies ever having said any of it. What do we tell these clients? To think differently about these situations? To figure out new and better ways of communicating? To figure out a magical way to talk about their histories without talking about the behavior of the other players? To bring their authentic best self into the relationship, despite years of their authentic best self being pummeled every time it presents to the difficult, antagonistic, dare we say, narcissistic person in their lives? Should we not be careful about sending clients back out to be re-abused? Or should we be educating them about these patterns so they can have their eyes wide open? Narcissistic abuse is a term and phenomenon mental health practitioners are beginning to use in a sort of underground manner. Those of us who talk about it are referring to a pattern observed in an individual who is experiencing deleterious effects of a high conflict, antagonistic, dysregulated person or persons in their lives. Most often, the abuser displays characteristics of narcissism, whether they meet diagnostic criteria for NPD or not. The pattern experienced by the survivor is characterized by self-doubt, second-guessing, anxiety, and other negative mood states, apathy, rumination, helplessness and hopelessness, social isolation, and shame. People or persons experiencing this pattern will endorse impairments in concentration, as well as other vegetative symptomatology, including sleep and appetite changes. It is a pattern that now really does need empirical validation. Only one article in the empirical literature has arisen on this as a clinical phenomenon, and it was in the nursing literature. Now, discrimination of this pattern from PTSD, complex PTSD, adjustment disorders, survivor patterns observed in intimate partner violence, and other patterns, including anxiety and depression, are clearly needed. Narcissistic abuse is also a wide-ranging construct and can be a result of parental, child, intimate partner, sibling, friend, or workplace relationships. And treatment approaches that are showing utility with people who have been experiencing narcissistic abuse include psychoeducation about these personality styles, validation of the client's experience, shoring up the client's defenses and coping resources, trauma work, family of origin issues, exploration of cognitive patterns, and management of co-occurring mental health issues. Adjunctive referral and consultation about divorce, custody, labor law, HR, and domestic violence are often essential to at least be able to listen to the client's experience in navigating this territory. It's actually quite simple, really. Small steps like validating the client's experience, teaching them the intransigence of these personality styles, and teaching them about ideological issues around narcissistic personality styles. All of this against the balancing act for the client of realistic expectations, boundaries, acceptance, grief, and compassion. All together, that becomes the work of therapy and then the work of life. And I know the criticism well. We have to be careful about using clinical terms when discussing people not in the room. We are only seeing one side of a story. I, as a therapist, want the client to talk about themselves and stop talking about other people. We have to be careful. We run the risk of gaslighting, which is doubting the reality of anyone, including our own clients, when we do this. For example, someone after 20 years of experiencing narcissistic abuse in a relationship, a person really may not want to hear from their therapist. Well, maybe that other person didn't mean it that way. Or, if it's so bad, why'd you stay? Clients experiencing these patterns are confused and have spent years generating rationalizations, walking on eggshells, and gaslighting themselves. It's our job to educate and help foster a client's coping and resilience as they deep dive into their experience while being given a realistic look at what these personalities are about. Education about these personality patterns may set people free from their stuck cycles of ongoing abuse. No, you don't need to diagnose the person not in the room. But when a person comes in for therapy and says their reality is being questioned, in other words, when they are gaslighted, we can actually empathize, and importantly, more importantly, we can explain. This is much bigger than a therapy room. Our reluctance, when it's there, to identify these patterns means that we run the risk of allowing these patterns to foment in organizations large and small, in governments, in the media, in society at large. When we are unwilling to recognize toxic cultures and patterns, even when we as psychologists should know how these patterns work, we enable and we embolden them. Mental health professionals should not be enabling the maintenance of systematic gaslighting and toxic cultures of work, relationships, and societies. These patterns are cultural and intergenerational, and bottom line, they are not good for anyone's mental health. Instead of hiding behind neutrality and safe outs, such as the Goldwater rule, we need to speak out about these patterns. We need to figure out how to measure this, and above all else, teach about it and study it, but not just dismiss it because it makes us uncomfortable. And that means taking on both narcissism and narcissistic abuse headlong. Somewhere along the line, we stopped questioning personality patterns that are bad for other people's mental health, or maybe we never did question them. And we run a risk as a profession of gaslighting a world that needs us desperately now to make sense of a world that has seemingly gone upside down. Whether it is wearing masks, human rights violations, toxic workplaces, health disparities, racism, and myriad other injustices that can, in part, actually be understood through a lens of narcissism. We can no longer shrug our shoulders and say, that's just how he is. We just need to adjust. Our job is not just to bear witness to human pain and suffering, but also to decode it and to not embolden it. Viktor Frankl said, an abnormal reaction to an abnormal situation is normal behavior. Instead of pathologizing those who suffer in antagonistic relationships, it's time we illuminate their path out of confusion. Thank you.